A model and a law graduate, Reeva Steenkamp was determined that South Africa would know who she was by early 2013.
Our Oscar Pistorius is suspected of killing his girlfriend. Police have confirmed a woman was shot four times at a house in Silver Lakes in Pretoria. She was declared dead on the scene.
She sent me a message in the beginning of the month and she said, "Gee, this month is going to be amazing. It's going to change our lives forever."
Quirky, creative, and funny, Reeva made friends easily, but she was also deeply compassionate. In a poem called My Garden, she ends with the verse, "I sit and think, the willow holding me, and watch the breezes give life and take. There, in my garden, I can see, each life is at stake."
She had, in the beginning, had found love, because she was loved like crazy by this guy, by Oscar. So, you know, when she even spoke about it, when it even started, like in the beginning stages, it was like a little overwhelming for her even. And I know that she did want love in her life, and at one stage we thought she had it. It got overwhelming. It really got overwhelming to a point.
Mr. Pistorius, did you at any time intend to kill Reeva?
I did not intend to kill Reeva, my lady, or anybody else for that matter. My lady, I've made a terrible mistake.
You made a mistake?
That's correct.
You killed a person, that's what you did, isn't it?
I made a mistake, my lady.
You killed Reeva Steenkamp, that's what you did?
I made a mistake, my lady.
You're repeating it three times. What was your mistake?
My mistake is that I took Reeva's life, my lady.
You killed her, you shot and killed her. Won't you take responsibility for that?
I fired four shots. When I realized the scale of what was happening, I stopped firing and I stood there and I was in shock. I don't know if I fired my...
Mr. Pistorius, Reeva doesn't have a life anymore because of what you've done. She's not alive anymore. So please, listen to the questions and give us the truth.
I'm angry now when I hear the details of exactly what happened. I'm angry now. I'm still forgiving, but I'm angry. I think he has to see me, the mother, the person who gave birth to her, but he's taken that away. That's what I want to see. That's why I want to look in his face, and he must look in mine. He must see now that I am there for justice for Reeva, no matter what happened.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick. Hello on a snowy day.
Today's episode is Shots in the Dark, The Murder of Reeva Steenkamp. So it was on Valentine's Day, 2013, when 29-year-old model Reeva Rebecca Steenkamp was shot dead by her boyfriend, Oscar Pistorius, while spending the night at Oscar's house. Now, she'd locked herself in the bathroom when Oscar shot her to death through the door. He would later claim that he thought she was an intruder. As a paralegal turned cover girl and Avon model, Reeva was a little bit famous, but her boyfriend, Oscar Pistorius, was very famous, especially where they lived in South Africa. He was the first amputee to win a non-disabled World Track medal. He was the first double-leg amputee to participate in the Olympics. So together, they seemed like a beautiful, successful couple on their way to big things. But that all ended on that Valentine's Day morning. Was it true, as Oscar would say, that he lived in fear of violent crime in South Africa? Or was this a case of domestic violence that ended, as it all too often does, in a woman's death? Come join us at the quiet end as we learn about the life of Reeva Steenkamp, the intersection of her life with that of Oscar Pistorius, and the tragic result. We'll also discuss the murder trial of Oscar and the controversial verdicts. But before we get going, I'm going to thank some 5-star reviewers. So a big thank you to Jelly Jar, Palomar Girl 1962, Karen Alden, Mucky Pup, A1958 Meemaw, Janny Sept 27, Nick, Jackie from New Hampshire, Ucar, Ill 21, Yucarl 21, Cat Giraffe, Alias C, and of course Turtle 46.
Don't forget Turtle Turtle 46.
Come on down to the quiet end.
We're saving you seats.
And Dick has brought a beautiful beer. What's the beer that you brought today?
Well, this beer got smuggled to me by a friend. So maybe I shouldn't say that. It was gifted to me by a friend. It's Castle 1895 Draft, which is brewed by South African Breweries in Johannesburg, South Africa. Now, this is a Euro Pale Lager, which I don't think we've talked about before.
It doesn't sound familiar to me.
Anyway, these beers have a significant hop flavor with moderate bitterness, a very solid malt body. They tend to be sweet and low alcohol. So these are your prototype session beers. You can drink a lot of them in a sitting because they're pretty low alcohol. To my mind, not very tasty, but tasty enough. Thirst quenching would be the way I'd put it. This particular one is a hazy, pale gold color. There's a moderately sized white head that disappears pretty quickly. It has an aroma of floral and spicy hops. The taste is the aforementioned hops and some crackers, like saltine crackers without the salt. So it's a crisp, clean, refreshing beer.
Okay. Well, let's open it up and then we'll head on down to the quiet end.
You got it.
Okay, let's head on down.
Let's go. It is the quiet end, truly, today. I think this blizzard is keeping people away from the bar.
Sure, that's right.
They're not all crazy like us.
Well, it gives us more room to get things done, right?
Yeah.
More space.
That's right.
Yeah.
We can spread out a little bit and do things our way without worrying about impinging on people.
Right, exactly. So this case, our victim is Reeva Steenkamp, and she was 29 years old when she was killed. Now, Reeva was born in Cape Town, South Africa, 1983, the youngest child to June and Barry Steenkamp. Her parents separated when she was young, and they struggled to make a living working on a horse farm for racing horses. Now, Reeva went to live with her mother when the parents separated, but money was always a concern. Now, as a teenager, Reeva began modeling. She was only 14 when she started. She was very beautiful, but she wanted more from life than just a career in modeling.
Well, yeah. That's a fleeting career.
Usually, yeah.
Even if you're a star.
Yes, but I guess if you were like Giselle, you could retire off modeling.
Well, yeah.
Quite comfortably.
There's only one Giselle.
Right. Now, her first boyfriend was a horse jockey, and they were together for a couple of years. And then in her early 20s, Reeva had this serious horse riding accident, which put her in the hospital for 4 months.
Yeah, she broke her back, didn't she?
Yes.
Serious.
Yeah, she was paralyzed, not knowing if she would ever walk again.
Yeah, boy, that'll set things in your mind.
Yeah, won't forget about that, will you?
No, for sure.
So after 8 or 9 months, she did finally recover, but her friends said that really just affected her. It never went away, and she never did get on a horse again either.
I wouldn't.
No. Well, they say get right back on the horse.
Yeah, get back in the saddle again. I think that's easier said than done.
Sure, I don't blame her. Now, she had another serious boyfriend when she lived in Johannesburg from 2008 to 2012. After they broke up, the two remained friends, and they still spoke and got together for coffee pretty often. Reeva was also the victim of an armed robbery at her mother's house in 2008, and the crime was never solved. So friends say that this experience left her fearful, left a mark on her as well. So she's this beautiful woman who seems to have everything, but she's been through some stuff.
She certainly has.
So she's a strong person.
There's some life-altering events there.
Absolutely. Now, she attended college and completed her law degree. She worked as a paralegal as well as a model. Then in 2011, she applied to the bar, and she planned to be a legal advocate by the time she was 30. But we know she never made it to 30.
No.
Now, as a model, Reeva was ranked number 40 in the FHM 100 Sexiest Women in the World poll of South African readers in 2011. And she was number 45 in 2012. So she's doing pretty well with this modeling.
It sounds like, although she dropped a few spots from 2011 to 2012.
Sure, but the competition must be fierce.
I'm sure it is.
She was a celebrity face in the Spirit Day anti-bullying campaign as well in 2012. And she was also the primary model for Avon in South Africa.
Now that sounds like a pretty big deal.
A good gig, yeah. Now Reeva also wanted to be an actress on television. She once worked as a presenter for Fashion TV in South Africa. And she also starred in television ads for Toyota, Reds, and Alder Pin Pop, which I'm not sure what that is. Might be a South African brand.
I would think, yeah. Now, is she still doing law degree stuff? It sounds like she's spending more time modeling and trying to get into TV and movies.
Well, she was, but she also did apply for the bar, so I think she was juggling both.
Okay.
Now, at the time of her death, Reeva was signed up to appear on season 5 of the reality TV show, Tropica Island of Treasure. And she'd filmed the series episodes on location in Jamaica. The series began airing as scheduled on February 16th, 2013, and that was just 2 days after her death. The first episode of the series was dedicated to Reeva and was preceded by a video tribute to her. Now, Reeva had just begun dating Oscar Pistorius in November of 2012. Oscar was born in 1986, so he was 3 years younger than Reeva, and he was born in Johannesburg, South Africa. He grew up with an older brother and a younger sister. Oscar was born with fibular hemimelia. Did I say that right?
You did.
Okay.
So what that means is he's missing the two smaller leg bones in each leg.
Right, the lower leg.
The lower leg. He has the tibia.
Which is the shin.
The shin bone. The fibula sits next to it. So he's missing those.
So did he have feet?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I think...
Do they usually have feet?
You may or may not have feet with that syndrome.
But it's not functional. If you don't have the fibula, you can't walk.
No. Okay. And he ended up having his legs amputated.
Yeah, he was only 11 months old when that happened.
Yeah.
And they amputated below his knees.
Right, so he had functioning knees.
Yes.
And absent lower legs.
Right. So in school, Oscar's disability didn't hold him back. He played water polo, tennis, and rugby, and did pretty well for himself.
He did. He wasn't handicapped with his absent legs. He also took part in Club Olympic wrestling. Now, he had a knee injury while playing rugby in June 2003, and he got introduced to running. In January 2004, while undergoing rehab at the University of Pretoria's High Performance Center, he met Coach Ample Lau, and running became his passion. So here he's trying to run on these ordinary prostheses.
Yeah, now was he trying to run on, like, the woodish ones?
Yeah.
Oh, my
gosh. The old-fashioned ones.
That would be hard.
But he became introduced to racing blades when he was fitted by a South African prosthetist, Francois van der Watt. This is in like 2004, 2005.
So how old was he then? He was
19,
born in 86.
18, 19.
Okay. So he was quite young.
Yeah. So he broke these pretty quickly with running. So the prosthetist van der Watt referred Oscar to an American prosthetist and Paralympic sprinter, so he should know.
Right.
Name is Brian Fraser. In the 2008 Summer Paralympics in Beijing, Oscar won 3 gold medals. He continued to compete in Paralympic and non-disabled races throughout 2011. On July 4, 2012, it was announced that he would be included in the South African Olympic team for the 400-meter race and the 4x400-meter relay race. And this was despite actually not having the qualifying times.
Really?
Really.
Now, why is that?
Well, I think that they were looking for the publicity.
Really? So you think he got kind of put in there?
There's no question
he
got
favoritism.
Got preferential treatment because his times didn't qualify, but they included him on the team anyway.
See, that's why I have you around, not just for the medicine, but for the sports stuff, because you know that.
It's for my good looks, right?
That too. Okay. Do you know anything else about that?
No.
That I might not know? Okay.
No, just that at least for the 400-meter time, he didn't qualify.
Okay. So Oscar was the first amputee runner to compete at the Olympic Games, and he took second place in the 400-meter race. He also was chosen to carry the South African flag for the closing ceremony.
He came in second in his heat in the
400... In the first heat of five runners, yeah.
In the 400-meter race. But he failed to advance. He didn't finish high enough in the succeeding heat. So
what is a heat?
Preliminary race.
Oh, okay.
So you race a certain number of people, and one, two, three, or four of them advance to the next round.
Okay. So he didn't really win. He just won in the heat.
He finished second in the heat,
right.
And he didn't qualify in the next heat, so he didn't race in the final.
Okay.
So he didn't medal.
But he got so much publicity.
Well, sure.
And that was because of the legs.
Because he's running against able-bodied people. And it's, you know, it's kind of uplifting to see someone who's disabled.
Sure, I can see that.
To perform well.
Right. But some people actually said he had an advantage with those blades. That was a controversy.
Oh, they originally banned the blades.
Well, then he couldn't run.
And he wasn't going to be able to run, but there was an appeal and he was allowed to run.
Oh, okay.
Even though they had done some studies that showed it did actually give him an advantage.
Okay.
But again, I think there were politics involved.
Okay.
But anyway, he was allowed to perform in the Olympics.
So in a later race, not the Olympics, I had heard that he got beaten by another person with two amputations.
Right. In the Paralympics, which follow the Olympics.
Right.
He lost in the 200-meter run to a guy, and Pistorius cried foul.
That's what I was going to say.
Which is kind of funny to me, because he was at the center of the controversy originally about gaining an advantage, and his claim was that the guy who beat him had an advantage because his blades were bigger or something.
Right. So some people have said that this was an insight, a look at how he could be kind of a poor sport, kind of a angry person.
I think from what we've read and what we've seen, there's a lot of indicators that he had some flaws in his character.
Okay, yeah.
I'll leave it at that for now.
He didn't seem to when he was younger. I kind of thought what they'd said, that the fame kind of made him a...
Well, yeah.
A big head,
we've talked about
big
this
ego.
Before. You get enough people telling you how great you are, you start believing that.
Right.
So that's what happened with him.
Okay. And he became quite famous, especially in South Africa.
Yeah.
And he became known as the Blade Runner.
Right.
So he had sponsorship deals worth $2 million a year.
He was making pretty good money.
Yep. Sponsors included Nike, Gatorade, and Oakley.
Yeah, those are big guys.
Big ones. He purchased his home in a gated community, and he became interested in fast cars, speedboats, and then eventually guns. He owned several guns.
A lot of guns.
In 2009, he'd been seriously injured when he was thrown from a boat that he was speeding in on the Vaal River. The Vaal or Vaal?
Vaal.
Vaal River near Johannesburg.
I'm trying to translate into Dutch to German or something like that, so I think it's Vaal.
Okay. And he required surgery for some broken facial bones, but he recovered pretty quickly from that.
Yeah, and there was some controversy about that, and whether he was driving the boat or not, whether there was alcohol involved.
Really?
So there was some things that might have gotten brushed under the table.
There was some talk that he had a friend take the blame.
Right.
Because he was famous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we will see this happen another time, too.
Right. It's true. Well, Oscar and Reeva had only been dating for 3 months when he killed her. According to Reva's friends, she did love Oscar, but her relationship with Oscar had changed over this short course of their relationship. I mean, it's only been 3 months. If things are already changing, that's worrisome.
Well, definitely. And not just the length of time. I mean, you hardly know this guy, right?
Right.
Or vice versa. You hardly know each other. And things have already turned rather volatile.
That's not a good sign.
It's definitely not a good sign.
No. Well, some friends of Reeva would say that Oscar was very possessive and he had a temper. But Reeva went to be with Oscar in his home on February 13th, 2013. That night, she texted her best friend to tell her that she would be spending the night at Oscar's.
It was going to be a nice, intimate Valentine's Day.
Yeah, she brought him a present.
Yeah.
Yeah. But early on the morning of the 14th, Oscar shot and killed Reeva in his home. Reeva was locked in the toilet portion of the bathroom. So it's a large bathroom where you walk in and there's a tub in the sink, and then there's a separate little room for the toilet.
Right, and you can go in there and close the door.
Right, and lock it.
Right, and this is with, and someone else could be in the bathroom itself.
Right.
But you can be in your little cubicle behind a locked door.
Right. A lot of hotels kind of have that.
Yeah.
I don't know if they lock, but yeah.
Yeah, a little more privacy.
Right. So he admitted to shooting Reeva and causing her death, but he claimed that he had mistaken her for an intruder. So he said that he thought she was still in the bed.
You want me to rise to that already?
Well, I think we should talk about it a little bit. It's a good place to talk about it.
Sure.
Because she's locked in the toilet area. She has clothes on.
She does. That's what we found out.
Yeah. There were two cell phones.
Oh, there's lots of stuff that indicate that he knew where she was.
Absolutely. Also, they said that when he went to get his gun, it was on her side of the bed.
Yeah.
So how could he miss that she was there?
Well, and they brought a fan in from outside. So there was, to me, ample opportunity to see that she wasn't in bed with him.
Absolutely.
Anyway, I jump ahead too much.
I don't think so.
I'm too eager.
Well, the murder trial began on March 3rd of 2014, and Oscar was also charged with illegal possession of ammunition and two charges of firing a gun in a public space. So one was he fired a gun from a car, and another was an accidental misfire, I guess, in a restaurant. His friend claimed that they were handing the gun under the table, and it accidentally went off.
Put a hole in the floor.
That could have killed someone.
It could have.
Easily.
Or it could have hit somebody.
Yes. Just terrifying, I think.
But he got his friend to take the rap for him.
For a while, but it did come out.
I'm sure, eventually. But we've had, there's been a lot of instances in the stuff we've researched that show that he was kind of reckless, that he had a pretty volatile temper.
Right.
He got into a fight with some guy at a party.
Yeah, he was charged with assault or something for that one, right?
And he was sued by a girl who claimed he had slammed a door on her and injured her shin or her foot or something.
Yeah.
So there's instances that make him look like a hot-tempered person.
Yes. Well, the only time that Reeva's mother spoke with him was when Reeva was in the car with Oscar and called her mother and said that Oscar was driving like a maniac and wouldn't listen to her. So she put her mother on the phone with Oscar, and he did slow down for her.
Well, that's nice of him, isn't it?
It's kind of strange, isn't it?
It's really strange.
I'm really surprised that she put up with as much as she did.
Yeah, it sounds like this was not a relationship she'd want to be in.
You wouldn't think so.
But yet, she continued it.
Right.
Now, not to be terribly harsh, but some of my thoughts, because this is an intelligent woman.
Absolutely.
I think she's recognizing that this is maybe not the guy to be with, but she's kind of seduced by his fame. And it might help her career to be linked to him.
Well, that's a possibility.
Now, I mean, that sounds kind of harsh for her, but
Well, we're not saying that it would be totally because of that, but that is a lure.
But I'm thinking that might have played a role.
Sure.
Because if he was Joe Schmo, I don't think she'd be spending much time with him after the first couple dates.
Well, you don't think so, but plenty of smart women are in abusive relationships. Many of them.
Okay. I'll grant you that.
Yeah. So she may have been afraid. That's another possibility.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So the trial was presided by Judge, and this is a tough name for me, Thakazil Masipa, and two assessors. So South Africa, they don't have a jury system. That was abolished back in apartheid.
Okay. So they have a judge and two assistant judges, kind of?
Yeah, two advisors.
And the three of them come up with the verdict?
Right.
Okay.
Yep.
So does it have to be unanimous or 2-1 majority or what?
I don't know what it has to be. It was unanimous in this case,
okay.
So I don't know if it could be 2-1. Now, the opening statement of the prosecutor did acknowledge that the case was largely circumstantial And the defense's opening statement said that Oscar believed Reeva was still in the bed when he shot at what he thought was an intruder behind the toilet door. If the court decided that his actions were reasonable, he would be acquitted. If they concluded that his actions were unreasonable, he would be convicted of culpable homicide. And that is roughly the equivalent of manslaughter here in the United States.
Okay.
Also in England, I believe. And then murder would be if they thought that he purposely went to kill Reeva, which is what prosecutors believe.
And what I believe.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but I suspect you're leaning that way too.
Yes.
Because there's just too many things. I mean, you already mentioned that there was no real way he could miss the fact that she wasn't in bed with him.
That's one thing.
And why is he standing in front of a locked door, screaming at the door and shooting through it when he could have been out of the apartment or out of the house?
Yeah, or he could have called 911 and said, I have a gun on you. I'm calling 911. Don't move.
Right. There's plenty of opportunity there.
He wasn't really threatened.
Nope. And for a guy who's so afraid of crime that he lives in this gated community, he leaves his balcony door open.
True.
So he's kind of inviting intruders.
I guess so. I hadn't thought of that.
I guess I shouldn't say inviting intruders, but there is opportunity.
Yes. And just some of his behavior with guns in the past, the prosecution believed that he was eager to use the gun.
He loved guns.
Yes. It made him feel powerful.
Ooh.
Now, on the first 2 days of the trial, a witness testified to hearing arguing that lasted about an hour. Five witnesses testified to what were described as a woman's screams and gunshots on the night Reeva was killed. The defense cross-examined these witnesses and tried to establish that the screaming was actually Oscar screaming for help, and that the sounds they described as gunshots were actually the sound of the toilet door being broken down with the cricket bat. So the prosecution also brought in witnesses to testify about Oscar shooting a gun in a restaurant a couple of months prior to the killings.
Yeah, so they found that out.
Yeah.
And, I mean, there was a lot of testimony about whether this was a man screaming or a woman screaming. And I think all the witnesses who heard the screams steadfastly maintained that it was a woman.
They did.
Not a man.
Well, there were a couple people that lived close by that did say that it could have been him. But the people who initially said they heard screams, the ones who defense attorneys were trying to say were too far away,
said it was a woman.
And there's more about that. We'll talk about.
Oh, yeah. So there's one of the neighbors who is a physician, I think is a retired radiologist or something, Dr. Johann Stipp, testified that he found Oscar praying over Reeva's body when he went over to help after being woken by what he described as the sound of gunshots and a woman screaming. So he also testified that the bathroom light had been on and he'd seen a figure moving inside as he heard the screams. This is important because if someone was moving in the bathroom during the screaming, then it wasn't Oscar screaming for help after shooting Reeva.
Right. So that's a big point.
It is.
And if you believe that witness, you can't believe Oscar's story.
Well, it's not a believable story anyway. The court also heard testimony from a former girlfriend of Oscar's and from a security guard who was on duty the night of the shooting. The state pathologist gave graphic testimony about Reeva's injuries. As the pathologist was testifying, Oscar had to have a pail to vomit in because he was physically ill.
Yes. Well, he was very emotional at the trial.
He was.
That doesn't make him innocent.
Well, no.
No.
Makes him guilty.
Makes him guilty and, you know, maybe he's having some...
Repentant.
Repentant.
The court also heard testimony about messages sent on iPhones between Oscar and Reeva. 90% of the messages were loving and normal conversations.
Right.
But there were several where Reeva accused Oscar of being jealous and possessive, which he probably denied.
Yes. So in one message that Reeva sent less than 3 weeks before the shooting, she wrote, "I'm scared of you sometimes, of how you snap at me." And then she went on to describe his behavior as being nasty. Now, Oscar testified in his own defense, and his cross-examination was brutal.
Bet it was.
So the cross-examination took 5 days, and then the re-examination by his attorney only took 10 minutes. and that ended with Oscar reading Reeva's Valentine's Day card to him, which he said he opened the August after he killed her. And it read, "I think today is a good day to tell you that I love you." And the judge would say that this is just irrelevant.
Well, I would agree.
Yeah.
What's that got to do with anything?
It's true.
This was before she got killed that she wrote this.
Well, yes, she didn't write anything after, clearly. Right.
I mean, so, who cares?
Right. Just because she loved him has no bearing on the fact that he killed her.
None whatsoever.
Yes, I agree. The prosecution asked to have Oscar's mental condition evaluated independently after testimony from a psychiatrist for the defense had claimed that he had an anxiety disorder that made him hypervigilant about security. So they were also saying that being a disabled person made him feel more vulnerable than other people. So that would make him hypervigilant, anxious.
Well, I think you could be hypervigilant and anxious just because of the high crime rate. I'm not sure that I'd agree with the statement that being disabled made him more vigilant. I mean, he was pretty easily overcoming this disability.
Yes.
He had his prostheses that he could slip on very quickly.
Yes. So. Yes. Well, so having a fear of crime in South Africa is a reasonable thing. It is a problem there, violence.
There's a lot of crime and violence in South Africa. That's why people are living in these gated communities with barbed wire or along fences and stuff. I mean, it must be difficult if you're a higher income person to be living there and be worried about your safety all the time.
Yes. Yep.
And they have a lot of gun-related deaths. Speaking of shooting people.
Okay.
The interesting thing is that even though South Africa is like 16th in the world for numbers of guns per person or per population, they're the second highest, only behind the United States. We have the lead by far.
That's depressing.
Isn't it? But they have the second highest gun-related death rate in the world.
Okay.
So you look at this where they don't have that many guns per population or per segment of the population, but they're the second highest gun-related deaths. So there's a lot of crime and violence in regard to guns in South Africa.
Yes, and I was reading they have more robberies and other violent crimes than the U.S. does.
They do.
So even if you don't get killed, you're more likely to be held up at gunpoint.
Yeah. Well, and Reeva could have testified to that because she was.
Right, right.
Has to be a scary thing, people with guns.
It is, and I hope we never have to deal with it. The trial was put on hold then because of the psychiatric evaluation, because they wanted to do an independent one, because they weren't really, the prosecution wasn't liking what the defense's psychiatrist was saying. He was trying to make excuses for Oscar, basically.
Yeah. But don't they, I mean, in the United States, each side has their own expert to testify to that.
Yeah.
So.
Well, maybe they didn't think it was going to be an issue until then.
So the defense had a psychiatric expert, but the prosecution didn't. And they said, oh, wait a minute, we need to.
I guess so. I mean, I'm not sure exactly how it went, but yes. They went ahead and had an evaluation. And the evaluation found that Oscar was not mentally incapacitated to the extent where he could not tell right from wrong, but it did say that he suffered from some anxiety and PTSD,
definitely,
which I don't think is really a mitigating factor in this case.
No.
Now, the surgeon who had amputated Oscar's lower legs when he was 11 months old testified about the effects of walking or standing on stumps, and then an acoustic engineer testified that if Reeva was screaming in the toilet room, it was unlikely that the screams would be audible were intelligible to the witnesses who testified earlier. But then in cross-examination, the expert conceded that it was possible that they had heard Reeva. I imagine, well, if you're screaming for your life, you're screaming loudly.
Yeah. So, and the defense is saying that all these people were hallucinating? That
basically, yeah. That they thought they heard a woman, but they didn't. And that some of their times were wrong. So these witnesses weren't given a lot of credit.
No, they weren't. But I was impressed with how they stuck to their stories.
They did. Mm-hmm. Now, in the closing arguments, the prosecutor said that Oscar had concocted a snowball of lies and demanded that he face the consequences. The defense attorney described Oscar's reaction to danger as being like that of an abused woman, which I find ironic.
No kidding. More than ironic.
Yes. So they're saying because he's a disabled person living in a high crime area, that he's emotionally damaged like an abused woman.
It's almost laughable.
So in the verdict, Oscar Pistorius was convicted only of culpable homicide, not murder. He was acquitted of murder. And then there was a sentencing hearing from October 13th to October 21st, and they gave him a sentence of a maximum of 5 years. So he received a 3-year suspended prison sentence for the separate reckless endangerment conviction for the gun, and then the 5 years for the murder. Well, for the culpable homicide.
Culpable homicide.
Right.
Sounds like a slap on the wrist.
A lot of people felt that way. So the prosecution had accused Oscar of premeditated murder, right? But the judge told the court that the state had failed to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he had committed premeditated murder. Based on objective facts, she accepted the defense's timeline that shots were fired around 3:12 a.m. So this meant that some of the state's witnesses who claimed that they heard a woman screaming after that time must have been genuinely mistaken, she said. So see, what do you think of that?
See, now I just don't see how you can discount not just one witness, but several witnesses.
Yes.
That heard a woman scream.
Right.
So how do you discount that?
I don't know. But the judge accepted that Oscar had believed Reeva was still in the bed because, she said, it was highly improbable that he would have made up the story so quickly. So another thing that she said as I was watching parts of the trial was that he was so emotional. You know, when he carried her downstairs after shooting her, he was crying and he was trying to give her CPR. But like we said before, that doesn't make him innocent. It makes him repentant.
Exactly.
But I think she took that. My interpretation is she took that to kind of show that he was innocent.
Yeah, I think she read more into that.
That he hadn't planned it.
Yeah.
So she did describe Oscar as a very poor and evasive witness, but then she said that it did not necessarily mean he was guilty.
Boy, this judge is all over the place.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, why would he be evasive if he wasn't guilty?
Well, exactly.
Guilty?
That's if she's discounting the stories from the witnesses and saying that he had reason to believe that there was an intruder, and then he's evasive. I mean, she's trying to get it both ways.
Strange, isn't it?
It is.
Well, a lot of people had a problem with this, not just us.
I know.
So the prosecution appealed in 2015 in the Supreme Court of Appeal, and it was heard before 5 judges. And by a unanimous decision, the court overturned the culpable homicide conviction and found him guilty of murder, though the prosecution was happy about that. Now, the judges found, for the prosecutor's argument, that Oscar knew that someone would die if he fired through the closed door into the small toilet cubicle.
Right?
Right.
I mean, it's a tiny enclosed place.
Even if he doesn't know who it is, that's premeditated murder.
He has reason to believe that he's going to harm somebody. Or kill somebody.
Yeah.
By shooting through the door.
I think so. It was it was like 4 meters squared. It's a small room.
Yeah. It's just got a toilet in it.
Right. So even if he didn't think it was her, which you're right, I do believe that he knew it was her.
Well, yeah.
I believe he chased her in there and she was
trying to
get help.
Locked the door.
Yes.
She had her cell phone that she dropped or something.
Right.
And she was barricaded in the toilet. And he knew she was in there.
Well, we think she was right in front of the door with the first shot, don't we? Because he hit her hip.
Yeah.
And then there were 3 shots?
I think there were 4 total.
Okay. Yeah. So there was the hip. There was...
He got her arm because he broke a bone in her arm.
And then there was her head and a finger.
Yeah.
And they thought maybe the finger got shot at the same time as her head, like she was holding her head.
Yeah.
But then some experts said no because there was no blood from her head or... head material on her hand.
Her hand.
Which I guess it doesn't really matter.
No, but he shot 3 or 4 bullets through there.
Yes, I think 4. I think you're right.
With the intention of killing whoever was behind the door.
Right. So whether it was her or not, it was murder.
Yeah. Because again, we get back to, let's suppose it was an intruder.
Okay, let's pretend for a minute.
And you got this person barricaded in the bathroom in the toilet door.
Right.
And you say, I have a gun. I'm going to call the police.
That would be reasonable.
Right.
Because there's not even any indication, if it was an intruder, that they were armed.
Right. There was no...
There were no threats.
No threats or harm done to Oscar or Reeva.
Right.
In the bedroom or anything like that.
Yes.
So, I guess maybe he was so cranked up, his adrenaline was flowing, and he just knew there was an intruder behind the door and he was shooting. But please, that wasn't the case. They had an argument because there was already some second thoughts or misgivings, despite the fact that she brought a Valentine's gift for him, but there was already some second thoughts about this relationship.
She had made that clear in some of her texts.
Right. And there were witnesses that heard arguments or people arguing.
That's true.
Before the shots rang out.
Right.
So that's, to me, what makes it a premeditated thing.
Well, that doctor seeing her in the bathroom, moving around, seeing someone in the bathroom.
Right.
That confirms it for me. If you believe him, like I said, you have to believe that he did it on purpose.
He did.
So the statement that the judges made, it read, although he may have been anxious, it is inconceivable that a rational person would have believed he was entitled to fire at this person with a heavy caliber firearm without taking even the most elementary precaution of firing a warning shot. Now, his claim he didn't fire a warning shot because he was afraid it would ricochet and hit him.
Okay.
But he could have...
See, I don't want to get hurt.
No. So I don't know about that. But I would think if someone did break in and they hid in the bathroom, like you were saying, it's not okay to shoot them to death.
No.
No, because they're not trying to kill you.
Of course, I don't know. We've done all these stand your ground law stuff before. Does South Africa have one of those type of things? But still.
Still.
I mean, you've got, if it is an intruder, you've got them barricaded in a bathroom stall.
Right.
They can't go anyplace without getting shot.
Right.
You call the police, and they come and help.
Yeah, I just don't believe that an intruder would go into the bathroom.
No.
I guess they could if they felt there was nowhere else to go, but an intruder's going to try and get out of there.
They would get out of there.
Right. Now, on July 6th, 2016, Oscar was sentenced to 6 years in prison for the murder conviction, and he could be released on parole as early as 2019. Now, the National Prosecuting Authority appealed the shockingly lenient sentence last August, and their appeal was rejected. So why this lenient sentence?
Well, I don't know. Is that a lenient sentence? What is a typical sentence for murder in South Africa?
I think it was 15 years.
Well, then,
is what he could have been looking at.
There must have been some doubt injected there that he got a 6-year sentence.
Well, I know. I just wonder if it was his emotion, how emotional he was, if it was the fact that he's disabled, if it's the fact that he's famous. What happened there?
There probably was a combination of events. But yeah, I think if the typical sentence is 15 years and he got 6, he got away with it. Because he was originally charged or given a 5-year sentence for the culpable homicide, right?
Yeah, so there's not much difference there.
So he gets an extra year. But
yes,
he's still eligible for parole in 2 more years.
Yes. So this last November, he was transferred from the jail to the Adderidgeville Correctional Center. And this is a smaller place, and it's better adapted for disabled people. It has facilities, including bathtubs in the cells, so it seems better than normal hardcore prison.
It sure does.
Now, not everyone has been happy with Pistorius's lenient sentence, us included, but research psychologist and gender scholar Peggy Drexler wrote in a 2014 article that the neighbors who heard Reeva's screams and the signs of domestic abuse were ignored by the judge.
Well, yeah. They were.
But according to Peggy Drexler, this isn't surprising. She sees this all the time, she says. She compared Reeva's texts, which seemed apologetic and loving in the face of his possessiveness and verbal abuse, to Janae Palmer Rice, who stood by her husband, former Baltimore Ravens running back Ray Rice. And she's talked about her part in the elevator punch. So she's taking partial responsibility for that.
Don't get me started.
So, well, maybe you should get started, because this is a trend with domestic abuse.
Well, I mean, she takes some responsibility in the sense that she was arguing with him.
Well, that's not, that you shouldn't be responsible for being hurt, though. That's the thing.
That's just a bullshit thing.
Right. But that's just, that's the abusive woman syndrome, or whatever you want to call it.
It is.
That you're taking. And then maybe she was lured by the fact that he was famous and she wanted him to keep playing football. Because what else is he going to do to support them? I don't know what else he could do.
Right. Plus, they weren't married then. They were engaged.
Oh.
So she's looking at, you know, if I accuse him of violence and don't say that I might have played a role in it and we break up, he's going to go somewhere else.
Sure, which is good.
Well, it is, but she's looking at...
Don't put words in her mouth.
All right, okay. I shouldn't. I'm going to shut up.
We don't know that.
I think his...
She could have been afraid of him.
His prowess as a football player played a role.
It may have.
As a professional athlete. So I think I'm going to probably stop here because I'm getting into some dangerous waters.
Well, no, I can see that many women, I mean, nobody's going to argue that there are women who want to be with professional athletes and men with money or fame and all that. That's absolutely true.
I think that's a truism.
Yes.
But I don't want to imply that she was going to lose a meal ticket.
No, because...
If she charged him or separated from him.
Right, because there are plenty of women who stay with poor men who beat them.
Right.
So there's the battered women syndrome, which is a whole separate thing.
There is. So
also,
we'll leave it at that, or I'll leave it at that.
No, you can keep talking, because also I'm thinking there could have been pressure on her from other people, right? Because if someone's a pro athlete, there are a lot of people that want him to succeed that are depending on him.
That's true.
Right? Because who else has to gain from him being famous or being on a good football team? And not being arrested.
His entourage.
So who's his entourage?
Well, his friends, the hangers-on. I mean, there's plenty of people.
Agent,
yeah.
Right. So she could have had pressure from other people as well. Like, well, if you let him get in trouble for this, we're going to all lose our jobs or whatever.
Yeah. Maybe they're putting it out as for the greater good.
What do you mean?
Of everybody.
Sure. Well, I could see there'd be pressure in that group of people.
Yeah.
Because he might be a meal ticket for several people, not just her.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
And then the thing with Reeva is, she might have, part of her attraction to Oscar may have been his fame and his athleticism. But just because she's attracted to him for that, that has nothing to do with the fact that she's in an abusive relationship.
No, you're right. It doesn't.
And I think it's really strange that she was very much into activism against domestic violence. But even she could be caught in a relationship like that. What does that tell you?
I know.
Yeah.
It makes you think.
It does make you think about the whole psychology of it and how that happens.
Right.
Because she knew better.
She did.
And she was obviously, well, I don't know if it's obvious, but most likely she was in a relationship that was unhealthy, where she was being mistreated, at least verbally.
It sure seems that way.
And look how it ended.
Yes.
Yeah. So it really makes you think, if that could happen to someone who's beautiful, successful, seems confident, seems aware of domestic violence, then it really could happen to any one of us.
Yeah, it's kind of insidious.
It is, right. So that's why it's just really important to me that we don't put any blame on someone just because they're with someone who's famous. I mean, there are all kinds of things that attract people.
Yes, there are.
Right. Okay. So that's all I have to say about that.
Okay.
Anything else on this case you want to talk about?
No, only that he got off easy.
He seems to, but you know, I've noticed in other countries, they do seem to have shorter sentences in many of them.
They do.
I mean, remember Ireland with Rachel O'Reilly's husband?
Yeah.
They don't get life like they do here quite as often, do they?
No, they sure don't.
No. Which sometimes I wonder about life sentences. Sometimes that does seem ridiculously long.
Well, that's a whole other topic.
Okay.
Isn't it?
All right. So you don't want to delve into that right now?
No.
As we're winding down.
I think if we're in the wind down phase of this discussion, this probably isn't the time to get into that discussion.
Okay. Yeah. And plus, we have a lot of feedback to do today.
Right.
So sometimes, Dickie, when I'm out walking the dogs, complete strangers run up to me and they say, Jill, Jill, can I join Team Tie Grabber? And I say, well, yes. And, you know, they don't even seem just surprised. They seem really relieved.
Well, I would be.
Yeah.
Because you know, if I were just an ordinary person not having anything to do with this, I would want to be a member of Team Tie Grabber.
Well, because you're a cool kind of with it guy that's always in on the best stuff.
And especially if I see this good-looking woman walking her dogs, I'd be going up to her anyway.
Good-looking dogs, too, right?
Well, they are.
They're older, but they're pretty good-looking.
We'll say mature.
Yes. Well, I say to them, I say it's easy. You just go to tiegrabber.com, and you click on Join Team Tie Grabber. Now,
that's all you got to do?
That's all you got to do.
Well.
But sometimes the really fanatical ones, they'll follow up asking that by asking, how else can I support the podcast, though?
Well, I'm sure there's other ways, right?
Because they're not satisfied with just that. They're fanatical types.
Yes.
So I just smile at them, and all I have to say is, shop the brewery.
Shop the brewery.
And they know what that means. I mean, these people are with it.
These are hip people.
Yeah, they're not people that don't know what's going on.
These are hip people.
Yes. So, no further explanations needed after that, right? It's all...
Well, no, because, again...
Then they know what to do.
These are people in the know.
Right.
So, all you got to do is give a few kind of keywords, and they know exactly what you're talking about.
Just tip them off, right?
Right.
And then everything's all set, and then the dogs wag their tails. We give a big hug, and they're on their way, and they've got this whole new sense of service and community as they're walking away.
That's right.
And Team Tie Grabber... You know, it not only supports independent podcasting, it also can give a life real purpose.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
What better purpose to listen to true crimes?
Right.
And drink beer.
And support them.
And support all that
Help
endeavor.
Pay for some of that beer. Because then you're actually a part of the podcast. You're not just on the outside listening. You're like participating in the podcast. It's an amazing thing.
It is. And I would just add one further little plug.
Okay.
If people have beer that they want to have reviewed on a broadcast, send some to me.
Absolutely.
Just let me know, and I'll give you my address, and you can send it off.
Yeah, you can email Dick at truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com, or if you really want to make Dick smile, send a voicemail on the website, because he loves those.
I just love voicemails.
If he gets a voicemail, he's just going to throw that address out there for pretty much anyone who asks.
That's right.
Okay, so let's take a little musical break, and then we'll talk some feedback. I've got some good stuff this week.
Okay, let's look at them.
All right. I got guns in my head, and they won't go. Spirits in my head, and they won't go. I got guns in my head, and they won't go. Spirits in my head, and they won't. I'd just like to take a minute to remind everyone about our Amazon link, tiegrabber.com/Amazon. For no additional cost to you, you can support True Crime Brewery by doing your shopping through our link. So that's tiegrabber.com/Amazon. If you have a minute to do that, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Okay, welcome to feedback.
So I have one from YouTube feedback on Lying in Wait, the murders of Haley Kiefer and Nicholas Brady.
Very haunting case, yeah.
Very haunting. I have actually two persons doing feedback. The first one is from Dominique and Kaylee Vlog. Is that like a vlog or something? I don't know what that is.
I don't know what it is, like a blog. I don't know.
Yeah. So they say, I have nightmares about this audio. I have my own kids, and they make mistakes. I know I did at 17. Not saying stealing is right, but it's not at all. But this case was a lunatic not laying in wait to catch intruders. He laid in wait at the ready tarp and all to kill the intruders, which happened to be these teens. This killer had plenty of opportunity and time to dial 911, but never did. He watched him outside, didn't call. He heard his window break, didn't call. He shot and executed them, still didn't call.
Not till the next day.
His neighbor called for him 24 hours later.
Yeah.
Are those the actions of a sane man? No. He knew what he did was worse than what they did, and he was trying to cover his guilt. He's a murderer, plain and simple.
I agree. And he didn't just wait. He actually lured them by moving his car far away.
Right. He enticed them in.
And it kind of has a little bit in common with today's case about if there's an intruder, it doesn't mean that you can just kill them.
Right.
You've got plenty of time to call for help. Or say, I have a gun, leave, or I'm calling 911.
You have some things.
Lots of things you could do.
Right. And we also have a comment on the same case from Catherine Dorsey, who says, clearly, if one decides to break into another's home, you have no right to assume that you're going to come out alive. But this Byron guy was just way too extra. That line about, I gave her a good clean finishing shot, was creepy, and that girl did not laugh. We can hear the entire event unfold. He also pretends to be talking to a lawyer after he slaughters them and does not call the police until the next day because he didn't want to bother law enforcement on a holiday. Creepy guy.
That's bullshit, the whole holiday thing.
Yeah.
Come on.
I mean, we know that.
But how did he sit in his house for 24 hours? That haunts me. With two dead bodies.
With two dead bodies.
How could you do it? I couldn't do it.
No.
Okay. I've got one from Amy on YouTube. And it's about how we mentioned the Kitty Genovese case when we were talking about Sylvia. So the message from Amy says, hey guys, absolutely love the podcast, huge true crime fan, and your podcast is one of my favorites. I wanted to make a few notes about Kitty Genovese, who you mentioned on the Sylvia Likens episode. This is actually a super fascinating case that would be really interesting for you guys to cover. The reasons civilians didn't call the police are all super layered. There are definitely people who could have helped her, but this is actually the case that helped to create the 911. And people would have had to leave their homes and go to the police call box outside in the street in order to alert the police. And nobody wanted to put their lives in danger. So there's more to it than what we thought. We were simplifying it quite a bit.
Well, yes, but I don't think we were oversimplifying it.
No. Well, if they had to go outside and they know someone's being killed outside, that's a whole different story.
That is true. But they could, I think, dial operator on the telephone.
Well, that's what I was going to ask, is wasn't there a way to call the police from your home phone?
I'm sure.
What year was this, in the 70s?
No, I think in the 60s.
Well, it's not like, I mean, that's a long time ago, but it's not like Little House on the Prairie.
No.
There was a way to call the police, I think.
I think so. I mean, I recognize the thoughts for your own safety, not wanting to go outside.
Of course.
And certainly not wanting to confront the person.
Well, yeah, I don't expect anyone to do that.
But it seems to me that you could pick up the phone and dial operator and tell the operator to get the police.
Well, I guess there's a lot more we could find out about it, because she says, the documentary The Witness on Netflix dispels a lot of rumors and assumptions about the case, so she highly recommends it. Also, she says, I don't know if y'all have heard of helium-infused beer, but it's a thing that exists, and I think it would make for a hilarious episode. Have you heard of that?
No.
We got to look into that. That sounds like a great time.
It would be hilarious, wouldn't it?
Yeah. How would that even work? I can't even imagine.
I have no idea.
All right. We're going to look into that, Amy. So Amy thanks us for keeping her morbidly entertained at work, and I think that's great. She also has a recommendation for a Montana beer. Oh, no, she says if you ever need a recommendation for a Montana beer, we should shoot her an email.
We certainly
will. Have we
done
Montana?
We haven't.
No, we haven't.
We seem to be concentrating on some of the states.
Well, we hit a lot of southern states, don't we?
We do.
Midwest and southern. So Montana, someday we should look and see what states we've missed and make an effort to do those states.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah. Okay, so Amy, we'll shoot you an email as soon as we have a Montana murder. Or if you have one, write us back and tell us about it.
Okay, now I have something that Judy F. forwarded by email regarding the Sarah Tokars case and talking about the boys. So Mike Tokars was the younger of the two. He was 4 years old when his mother, Sarah, was shot by a hitman in a 1992 murder case that ultimately led to his father, Fred Tokars. Mike Tokars and his brother, Rick, were raised in Bradenton, Florida. Mike is an aspiring journalist and an intern for a magazine in New York. And this note from 2012, November 2012, is the first time he's spoken publicly about his mother's murder. Though it wasn't the heavy and personal nature of this assignment that had me pacing and chain-smoking last Sunday. It was an unavoidable conversation with my brother Rick.
So you're quoting Mike here.
And I had not spoken about her. Alone.
No, we discussed earlier that Rick had trouble talking about it, the right. older boy, yeah.
In 10 years. This is how it went, is according to Mike.
Okay.
And this is from 2002. This is the 10th anniversary of Mom. Rick says, I know. Want to go surf? Cold front brought a swell. Me, yeah. And we went surfing.
That was it, huh?
A decade earlier, we were saying if Dad had been there, he would have shot him. And talking about Mom ended there. I realize that this looks sad on paper, but the fact of the matter is Rick and I don't need to discuss our lives before November 29th, 1992. I know how Rick feels about it, and Rick knows how I feel about it. We remember we were there. We've been thinking about it every day for 20 years, so there is no need to say it out loud. But this is not to say that Sarah Tokars has been absent from our lives during the last 2 decades. Not at all, actually. I speak about my mother frequently, to close friends who knew what happened, and also to acquaintances who don't. I never get it heavy outside of familiar zones, and have grown into a habit of talking about her the way other people talk about their mothers who are alive, because it's not necessary to include the horrible detail. Once I bragged to a cute hipster chick from Colorado that my mom went to college in Boulder in the 70s. I suppose I do this because I wish I was someone with the option of talking about my mom as if she were alive.
That makes me want to cry.
Yeah, isn't it?
That's really touching.
We survived, thanks to 6 amazing aunts and 1 strong uncle. I do, however, bring up the murder when talking with my aunts, the Ambrusco sisters. These are Sarah's sisters.
Yeah, she had 6 sisters.
Who, despite the immeasurable and ongoing sadness they've been forced to cope with, continue making extraordinary efforts to keep Sarah alive for Rick and me. And I do feel her in all of them, in 6 separate ways that come from each sister's similar but unique relationship with my mom. But there is also an all-encompassing force which they share as a whole. Attempting to describe this internal reaction would be useless, but I have observed the spirit does not come from an individual source, but from all of their efforts combined. It feels safe and warm, like Mass on Christmas morning. When I graduated from the University of South Florida last year, not a single aunt missed the commencement. They brought all the available uncles and cousins from each corner of America down to swampy Florida, the land of runaways and fresh starts where Rick and I grew up. All 6 of the Ambrusco girls sat together in place of their middle sister, Sarah, who I'm told once made a heck of a cheerleader, and cheered for me, the fortunate orphan. Later that night at a beach bar near our home in Bradenton, the entire family gathered around the table, drinking and laughing and smiling together, watching me on stage while I was playing guitar and singing with my band. At one point during our second set, while we were riffing on some instrumental number, I took the opportunity away from the microphone to get a good look at my family. I lit a cigarette and let the rhythm section carry on for a bit, smiled back, and tipped my bottled water their way for subtle cheers to all of them, but especially to my aunts. You might remember them from the extensive media coverage of the murder of Sarah Tokars, but for the sake of clarity and to give credit where it is due, I'm going to list them here. The Ambrusco girls are Teresa, Gretchen, Mary, Sarah, Joni, Karen, and Chrissy. They are all wonderful and have gone above and beyond for Rick and me. In the wake of such a deranged adversity, we were and are very lucky to have them. And in regard to my father, his name is Dr. John Ambrusco.
He turned out to be quite a young man. What a great writer.
Yeah. My grandfather always wanted boys, ended up with two as an old man. He is the reason that Rick and I survived. It was through his example that we learned to be strong and composed, to work hard, and to pray. What a nice story.
That's great. That's so sad, but also really impressed. Sarah would be proud.
It looks like.
Yeah, that's very touching. It's hard to move on from that. So I have Georgette from New York, who wrote to us about the Lacey Spears appeal. So a panel of appellate judges were considering their request by Lacey Spears to overturn her murder conviction for the salt poisoning death of her son Garnett. The crux of her defense lawyer's argument is that the evidence against Spears was not legally sufficient to support her conviction. The lawyers are also...
I would disagree, but anyway.
The lawyers are also challenging judicial rulings that they argue deprived Spears of a fair trial. Oral arguments had been scheduled, but both sides relied on written briefs they submitted, waiving an in-person appearance. So, basically, Lacey's appealing her conviction. She wants a new trial. Says, following the 5-week trial in 2015, the jury convicted Spears of second-degree murder under the theory that she showed a depraved indifference to human life. The theory is different than an intentional killing, but carries the same punishment. Acting State Supreme Court Justice Robert Neary sentenced her to 20 years in prison. So since she's been in prison, she's complained about being harassed. Remember, we talked in her episode about how inmates would put salt on her food.
Yeah.
People who kill children do not fare well in prison.
No, they don't.
Which seems fair enough to me. But even the second degree, I don't know if that's great, because I feel like maybe he was starting to talk and maybe she purposely did kill him at that point. There's a good possibility of that to me.
Yeah.
Or it almost seems like she wanted to end his life at that point.
That's the impression I get. And we talked about this between us, that he's getting to the point, or getting old enough to be able to tell people that his mother was hurting him.
Right, because he was very outgoing, really great kid.
And there's no question in my mind that she intentionally poisoned him with salt.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm not even questioning that. I'm just questioning, was it a continuation of her Munchausen for attention? Or was it she actually planning to murder him at that point?
Right.
And I kind of feel like she was actually murdering him.
I think so. Yeah. I don't think that's a far-fetched idea.
And I think early on I was able to have some actual sympathy towards her, which a lot of people don't have. But then when it got to the point where he's in the hospital at death's door and that sick and she did that, I feel like she really was a murderer at that point.
I think she was.
Yeah. So, we'll see how that goes with her appeal. I think that was back in December when they started on that, so I don't think we have a result on that. Unless somebody knows different, please write in and let us know. Do you have anything else?
I do. This is a very interesting one. This is from our very early podcast, and we did a 3-part series on Michael Peterson.
The Staircase.
The Staircase.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an email from Melissa in Baltimore about this case. A judge ruled in a hearing Monday.
That was recently.
Monday recently. That Durham novelist Michael Peterson will stand trial in the 2001 murder of his wife, Kathleen. The trial was set for May 8th, 2017.
So this will be his third trial, right?
Third or fourth.
Well, he was convicted. Did he have a hung jury and then he was convicted? It's been such a long time.
Yeah.
But I know that he was not exonerated because they still had the option to retry him, obviously.
Right.
And I heard he was working at, was it a Dairy Queen or something in the area? He was working a manual labor job kind of thing, or a retail type job. He's lost the beautiful house.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, he's
lost
almost destitute.
Yeah.
Well, here's what they said. Lawyers for Peterson argued that key DNA evidence can't be retested because it is in such poor condition. Peterson's children were in court with him and started crying when the judge ruled the case would not be dismissed. We were hoping that this would be the end, but it's not, so we tee up and prepare for trial in May, said defense attorney Mary Jude Darrow.
That's a new attorney. That wasn't the one in the documentary back when he had his trial that we covered.
There was a guy and a woman, right? Weren't there two attorneys? I mean, the guy with the beard got most of the airplay.
Right.
But I think there was
the guy
woman.
From New York.
Anyway, Peterson, who was also a former newspaper columnist and candidate for mayor of Durham, was convicted of first-degree murder in connection with her death in 2003 and sentenced to life in prison without parole. However, in 2011, he was ordered released, pending a new trial by Superior Court Judge Orlando Hudson. Hudson found that State Bureau of Investigation blood analyst Dwayne Deaver gave false and misleading testimony at Peterson's first trial.
Right.
He certainly did.
He did.
The North Carolina Supreme Court later upheld that decision.
So this is a case that stayed with me ever since we did it. And it was our very, well, maybe it was our second thing that we did for a podcast. Very early on, really super bad audio quality, but it's one that really stuck with me. It was a 10-part documentary, a fascinating case. And I don't think he did it. Do you think he did it? How do you feel about that now, looking back?
No, I think when we look back on it, that there was enough evidence that he didn't do it.
Right. And you know what I really have believed in lately is the owl theory, which I think I actually believed in that back when we did it. So maybe it's not new.
It's not new.
But you know, they did...
You were promoting that theory.
Well, they did a whole episode on it on the podcast Criminal a little while back, mm-hmm. where they spoke to a neighbor who'd been attacked by an owl. So if you have a chance to listen to that, it's just like a little half-hour episode. And what owls can actually do, and it makes a lot of sense. If you look at her wounds, there was a neighbor nearby who was attacked by an owl.
Mm-hmm.
She'd been drinking. She could have gone out front, and the owl could have hit her in the head, done the damage. And then if she tried to get up the stairs and fell, I mean, it really would explain the whole thing.
I think it could.
I don't really see that he had a motive to kill her. I don't see him as killing her.
No.
No, so it's interesting. I really am definitely going to follow that
case. Have to keep an eye on when the trial starts.
Yeah, we might do another episode on that because this is a fascinating case.
I think it would be worthwhile.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to start looking into where he's been and what's going on with that. So this lawyer, do you think she's still working with his legal team he had before?
Doesn't say.
Okay, so we'll have to check that out.
Yeah, the gist of the article is that they're going to have to decide how the DNA evidence is held up and whether they can present it or retest it.
Well, what's the DNA evidence? I mean, what kind of DNA are we looking at there? She was leaning all over the stairway.
Yeah.
What was his DNA involved? I don't know. Because they said that he had hit her with a stick.
With the blowpipe.
Right. So I didn't think DNA was a big part of it. So I don't know about that.
Well, there's a controversy about how accurate the DNA evidence could be at this stage.
Okay. So, all right. So that'll be really interesting to follow. It's coming up in like 6 weeks.
Not too long.
Really interesting. So we'll stay on top of that. I think that's the case where you got into trouble about the North Carolina jurors.
Well, I
might
have.
You thought that you said they were a little prejudiced because they were from the South, and boy, hellfire rained down on you for that.
Yes.
So you have to watch your step from here on out.
Well, I learned my lesson.
You did. Been much better since then.
I'm trying to be.
Yeah. So I just had an interesting article that was sent to us by Greta via email, and it was regarding the Sylvia Likens episode, that she was answering our question about why does a parent single out one child for abuse? We talked about that.
Right.
And you thought that maybe the one child was, I don't know.
Well, I just said that somehow that one child was more vulnerable.
Vulnerable. Okay.
And not invited more punishment, but in the eye of the person doing the brutality, that was the kid that deserved it more.
Well, sure. Yeah. So Greta sent me this article. It says, there are many possible reasons a parent might target just one child for abuse, and the situation is not that uncommon, experts say. Investigators don't know why it happened in Kansas City last week when an anonymous call led police and caseworkers to a 10-year-old girl, malnourished and locked in a closet with her own waist. But experts weren't shocked. So maybe a child reminds a parent of something bad, a rape or a former partner. Or maybe a child has special needs, which makes me think of Erica Parsons.
Erica Parsons, right. There's a special needs child.
Yes, frustrating parent who doesn't know how to meet those needs. It could be the child is just the most defiant in the family, which didn't seem the case with Sylvia or with Erica Lynn Parsons.
No.
It's not atypical, said Deborah Wolf, the executive director of the Field Center for Children's Policy Practice Research at the University of Pennsylvania. In abusive households, it's not unusual for one child to be singled out as the problem child. Rice, who could not speak to the Kansas City case specifically, has heard about several examples of targeted abuse in her work at CASA, Court-Appointed Special Advocates. Okay. We have those. I've heard of that up here.
Yeah.
Which provides volunteer support for abused and neglected children throughout the court process. One child may be more difficult to manage. Many have physical or medical needs that cause the parent to be frustrated, and they lose their ability to properly control their own behavior. A number of things can trigger these reactions, such as misbehavior or resistance to even potty training, so even a young child. In other cases, the child represents something negative to the parent, causing the parent to relive a trauma, such as the parent's own abuse. But what's the difference between a parent who gets frustrated with the trials of parenting and a parent who becomes abusive, particularly toward a certain child? Rational people expect rational answers for irrational behavior. Usually it's a series or number of different issues that can cause this, Greta says. If a child is viewed as different, it may cause a negative reaction that would increase the likelihood of them being scapegoated in a family. Well, that's interesting. We had kind of touched on that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think we went through some of those points.
An interesting thing that Greta also said was that the victim of the abuse is not the only one that suffers. The other children suffer as well.
Oh, no question.
Right, because they're being raised in that environment.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the way it was with Erica Lynn Parsons' brother. He actually, when he was younger, participated in the abuse.
Yes.
And as he got older, he realized it was wrong and said something about it, but he said he's had to live with that ever since.
Mm-hmm.
So that's messed him up.
Yes, it has.
Yeah. Thank you, Greta. Is that our last one?
I don't have any more.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, and we'll be back next week.
With a new case.
Keep the feedback coming.
And a new beer.
Yes. We'd like to get your feedback, your 5-star reviews, and we appreciate you listening, as always.
See you at the quiet end.
Okay. Bye-bye. I'd just like to take a minute to remind everyone about our Amazon link, tygrabber.com/Amazon. For no additional cost to you, you can support True Crime Brewery by doing your shopping through our link. So that's tygrabber.com/Amazon. If you have a minute to do that, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Okay, welcome to feedback.
So I have one from YouTube feedback on Lying in Wait, the murders of Haley Kiefer and Nicholas Brady.
Very haunting case, yeah.
Very haunting. I have actually two persons doing feedback. The first one is from Dominique and Kaylee Vlog. Is that like a vlog or something? I don't know what that is.
I don't know what it is, like a blog. I don't know.
Yeah. So they say, I have nightmares about this audio. I have my own kids, and they make mistakes. I know I did at 17. Not saying stealing is right, but it's not at all. But this case was a lunatic not laying in wait to catch intruders. He laid in wait at the ready tarp and all to kill the intruders, which happened to be these teens. This killer had plenty of opportunity and time to dial 911, but never did. He watched him outside, didn't call. He heard his window break, didn't call. He shot and executed them, still didn't call.
Not till the next day.
His neighbor called for him 24 hours later.
Yeah.
Are those the actions of a sane man? No. He knew what he did was worse than what they did, and he was trying to cover his guilt. He's a murderer, plain and simple.
I agree. And he didn't just wait. He actually lured them by moving his car far away.
Right. He enticed them in.
And it kind of has a little bit in common with today's case about if there's an intruder, it doesn't mean that you can just kill them.
Right.
Right. You've got plenty of time to call for help or say, I have a gun, leave, or I'm calling 911.
You have some things.
Lots of things you could do.
Right. And we also have a comment on the same case from Catherine Dorsey, who says, clearly, if one decides to break into another's home, you have no right to assume that you're going to come out alive. But this Byron guy was just way too extra. That line about, I gave her a good clean finishing shot, was creepy, and that girl did not laugh. We can hear the entire event unfold. He also pretends to be talking to a lawyer after he slaughters them and does not call the police until the next day because he didn't want to bother law enforcement on a holiday day.
Yeah, she brought him a present.
Yeah.
Yeah. But early on the morning of the 14th, Oscar shot and killed Reeva in his home. Reeva was locked in the toilet portion of the bathroom. So it's a large bathroom where you walk in and there's a tub in the sink. And then there's a separate little room for the toilet.
Right. And you can go in there and close the door.
Right. And lock it.
Right. And this is and someone else could be in the bathroom itself.
Right.
But you can be in your little cubicle behind a locked door.
Right. A lot of hotels kind of have that.
Yeah.
I don't know if they lock, but yeah.
Yeah. A little more privacy.
Right. So he admitted to shooting Reeva and causing her death, but he claimed that he had mistaken her for an intruder. So he said that he thought she was still in the bed.
You want me to rise to that already?
Well, I think we should talk about it a little bit. It's a good place to talk about it.
Sure.
Because she's locked in the toilet area. She has clothes on.
She does. That's what we found out.
Yeah. There were two cell phones.
Oh, there's lots of stuff that indicate that he knew where she was.
Absolutely. Also, they said that when he went to get his gun, it was on her side of the bed.
Yeah.
So how could he miss that she was there?
Well, they brought a fan in from outside. So there was, to me, ample opportunity to see that she wasn't in bed with him.
Absolutely.
Anyway, I jump ahead too much.
I don't think so.
I'm too eager.
Well, the murder trial began on March 3rd of 2014, and Oscar was also charged with illegal possession of ammunition and two charges of firing a gun in a public space. So one was he fired a gun from a car, and another was an accidental misfire, I guess, in a restaurant. He claimed that he was, well, his friend claimed that they were handing the gun under the table, and it accidentally went off.
Went off, and put a hole in the floor.
That could have killed someone.
It could have.
Easily.
Or it could have hit somebody.
Yes. Just terrifying, I think.
But he got his friend to take the rap for him.
For a while, but it did come out.
I'm sure, eventually. But there's been a lot of instances in the stuff we've researched that show that he was kind of reckless, that he had a pretty volatile temper.
Right.
He got into a fight with some guy at a party.
Yeah, he was charged with assault or something for that one, right?
And he was sued by a girl who claimed he had slammed a door on her and injured her shin or her foot or something.
Yeah.
So there's instances that make him look like a hot-tempered person.
Yes. Well, the only time that Reeva's mother spoke with him was when Reeva was in the car with Oscar and called her mother. They didn't. And
See?
That some of their times were wrong. So these witnesses weren't given a lot of credit.
No, they weren't. But I was impressed with how they stuck to their stories.
They did. Mm-hmm. Now, in the closing arguments, the prosecutor said that Oscar had concocted a snowball of lies and demanded that he face the consequences. The defense attorney described Oscar's reaction to danger as being like that of an abused woman, which I find ironic.
No kidding. More than ironic.
Yes. So they're saying because he's a disabled person living in a high crime area, that he's emotionally damaged like an abused woman.
It's almost laughable.
So in the verdict, Oscar Pistorius was convicted only of culpable homicide, not murder. He was acquitted of murder. And then there was a sentencing hearing from October 13th to October 21st, and they gave him a sentence of a maximum of 5 years. So he received a 3-year suspended prison sentence for the separate reckless endangerment conviction for the gun, and then the 5 years for the murder. Well, for the culpable homicide.
Culpable homicide.
Right.
Sounds like a slap on the wrist.
A lot of people felt that way. So the prosecution had accused Oscar of premeditated murder, right? But the judge told the court that the state had failed to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he had committed premeditated murder. Based on objective facts, she accepted the defense's timeline that shots were fired around 3:12 a.m. So this meant that some of the state's witnesses who claimed that they heard a woman screaming after that time must have been genuinely mistaken, she said. So what do you think of that?
See, now I just don't see how you can discount not just one witness, but several witnesses.
Yes.
That heard a woman scream.
Right.
So how do you discount that?
I don't know. But the judge accepted that Oscar had believed Reeva was still in the bed because, she said, it was highly improbable that he would have made up the story so quickly. So another thing that she said as I was watching parts of the trial was that he was so emotional. You know, when he carried her downstairs after shooting her, he was crying and he was trying to give her CPR. But like we said before, that doesn't make him innocent. It makes him repentant.
Exactly.
But I think she took that. My interpretation is she took that to kind of show that he was innocent.
Yeah, I think she read more into that.
That he hadn't planned it.
Yeah.
So she did describe Oscar as a very poor and evasive witness, but then she said that it did not necessarily mean he was guilty.
Boy, this judge is all over the place.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, why would he be evasive if he wasn't guilty?
Well, exactly.
Guilty?
That's if she's discounting the stories from the witnesses and saying...
Struggled to make a living working on a horse farm for racing horses. Now, Reeva went to live with her mother when the parents separated, but money was always a concern. Now, as a teenager, Reeva began modeling. She was only 14 when she started. She was very beautiful, but she wanted more from life than just a career in modeling.
Well, yeah. That's a fleeting career.
Usually, yeah.
Even if you're a star.
Yes, but I guess if you were like Giselle, you could retire off modeling.
Well, yeah.
Quite comfortably.
But there's only one Giselle.
Right. Now, her first boyfriend was a horse jockey, and they were together for a couple of years. And then in her early 20s, Reeva had this serious horse riding accident, which put her in the hospital for 4 months.
Yeah, she broke her back, didn't she?
Yes.
Serious.
Yeah, she was paralyzed, not knowing if she would ever walk again.
Yeah, boy, that'll set things in your mind.
Yeah, won't forget about that, will you?
No, for sure.
So after 8 or 9 months, she did finally recover, but her friends said that that really just affected her. It never went away, and she never did get on a horse again either.
I wouldn't.
No. Well, they say get right back on the horse.
Yeah, get back in the saddle again. I think that's easier said than done.
Sure. I don't blame her. Now, she had another serious boyfriend when she lived in Johannesburg from 2008 to 2012. After they broke up, the two remained friends, and they still spoke and got together for coffee pretty often. Reeva was also the victim of an armed robbery at her mother's house in 2008, and the crime was never solved. So friends say that this experience left her fearful, left a mark on her as well. So she's this beautiful woman who seems to have everything, but she's been through some stuff.
She certainly has.
So she's a strong person.
There's some life-altering events there.
Absolutely. Now, she attended college and completed her law degree. She worked as a paralegal as well as a model. Then in 2011, she applied to the bar, and she planned to be a legal advocate by the time she was 30. But we know she never made it to 30.
No.
Now, as a model, Reeva was ranked number 40 in the FHM 100 Sexiest Women in the World poll of South African readers in 2011. And she was number 45 in 2012. So she's doing pretty well with this modeling.
It sounds like, although she dropped a few spots from 2011 to 2012.
Sure, but the competition must be fierce.
I'm sure it is.
She was a celebrity face in the Spirit Day anti-bullying campaign as well in 2012. And she was also the primary model for Avon in South Africa.
Now that sounds like a pretty big deal.
A good gig, yeah. Now Reeva also wanted to be an actress on television. Complete strangers run up to me and they say, Jill, Jill. And I join Team Tie Grabber. And I say, well, yes. And you know, they don't even seem just surprised. They seem really relieved.
Well, I would be.
Yeah.
Because if I were just an ordinary person not having anything to do with this, I would want to be a member of Team Tie Grabber.
Well, because you're a cool kind of with-it guy that's always in on the best stuff.
And especially if I see this good-looking woman walking her dogs, I'd be going up to her anyway.
Good-looking dogs, too, right?
Well, they are.
They're older, but they're pretty good-looking.
We'll say mature.
Yes. Well, I say to them, I say it's easy. You just go to tiegrabber.com and you click on Join Team Tie Grabber.
Now, that's all you got to do?
That's all you got to do.
Well.
But sometimes the really fanatical ones, they'll follow up asking that by asking, how else can I support the podcast, though?
Well, I'm sure there's other ways, right?
Because they're not satisfied with just that. They're fanatical types.
Yes.
So I just smile at them, and all I have to say is, shop the brewery.
Shop the brewery.
And they know what that means. I mean, these people are with it.
These are hip people.
Yeah, they're not people that don't know what's going on.
These are hip people.
Yes. So, no further explanations needed after that, right? It's all...
Well, no, because again...
Then they know what to do.
These are people in the know.
Right.
So all you got to do is give a few kind of keywords, and they know exactly what you're talking about.
Just tip them off, right?
Right.
And then everything's all set, and then the dogs wag their tails. We give a big hug, and they're on their way, and they've got this whole new sense of service and community as they're walking away.
That's right.
And Team Tie Grabber, you know, it not only supports independent podcasting, it also can give a life real purpose.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
What better purpose to listen to true crimes?
Right.
And drink beer.
And support them.
And support all that
Help
endeavor.
Pay for some of that beer. Because then you're actually a part of the podcast. You're not just on the outside listening. You're like participating in the podcast. It's an amazing thing.
It is. And I would just add one further little plug.
Okay.
If people have beer that they want to have reviewed on a broadcast, send some to me.
Absolutely.
Just let me know, and I'll give you my address, and you can send it off.
Yeah, you can email Dick at truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com, or if you really want to make Dick smile, send a voicemail on the website, because he loves those.
I just love voicemails.
If he gets a voicemail, he's just going to throw that address out there for pretty much anyone who asks.
That's right.
Okay, so let's take a little musical break, and then we'll talk some feedback. I've got some good stuff this week.
Okay, let's look at them.
All right. I got guns in my head, and they won't go. Spirits in my head, and they won't go. I got guns in my head, and they won't go. Spirits in my head, and they won't.
Now it is for the greater good.
What do you mean?
Of everybody.
Sure. Well, I could see there'd be pressure in that group of people.
Yeah.
Because he might be a meal ticket for several people, not just her.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
And then the thing with Reeva is, yeah, she might have, part of her attraction to Oscar may have been his fame and his athleticism, but just because she's attracted to him for that, that has nothing to do with the fact that she's in an abusive relationship.
No, you're right. It doesn't.
And I think it's really strange that she was very much into activism against domestic violence. But even she could be caught in a relationship like that. What does that tell you?
I know.
Yeah.
It makes you think.
It does make you think about the whole psychology of it and how that happens.
Right.
Because she knew better.
She did.
And she was obviously, well, I don't know if it's obvious, but most likely she was in a relationship that was unhealthy, where she was being mistreated, at least verbally.
It sure seems that way.
And look how it ended.
Yes.
Yeah. So it really makes you think if that could happen to someone who's beautiful, successful, seems confident, seems aware of domestic violence, then it really could happen to any one of us.
Yeah. It's kind of insidious.
It is, right. So that's why it's just really important to me that we don't put any blame on someone just because they're with someone who's famous. I mean, there are all kinds of things that attract people.
Yes, there are.
Right. Okay. So that's all I have to say about that.
Okay.
Anything else on this case you want to talk about?
No, only that he got off easy.
He seems to, but you know, I've noticed in other countries, they do seem to have shorter sentences in many of them.
They do.
I mean, remember, Ireland with Rachel O'Reilly's husband?
Yeah.
They don't get life like they do here quite as often, do they?
No, they sure don't.
No. Which sometimes I wonder about life sentences. Sometimes that does seem ridiculously long.
Well, that's a whole other topic.
Okay.
Isn't it?
All right. So you don't want to delve into that right now?
No.
As we're winding down.
I think if we're in the wind down phase of this discussion, this probably isn't the time to get into that discussion.
Okay. Yeah, and plus we have a lot of feedback to do today.
Right.
So sometimes, Dickie, when I'm out walking the dogs, complete strangers run up to me and they say, Jill, Jill, can I join Team Tie Grabber? And I say, well, yes. And you know, they don't even seem just surprised. They seem really relieved.
Well, I would be.
Yeah.
Because you know, if I were just an ordinary person not having anything to do with this, I would want to be a member of Team Tie Grabber.
Well, because you're a cool kind of with-it guy that's always in on the best stuff.
And especially if I see this good-looking woman walking her dogs, I'd be going up to her anyway.
Good-looking dogs. They're squared. It's a small room.
Yeah. It's just got a toilet in it.
Right. So even if he didn't think it was her, which you're right, I do believe that he knew it was her.
Well, yeah.
I believe he chased her in there, and she was
trying
to get help.
Locked the door.
Yes.
She had her cell phone that she dropped or something.
Right.
And she was barricaded in the toilet, and he knew she was in there.
Well, we think she was right in front of the door with the first shot, don't we? Because he hit her hip.
Yeah.
And then there were three shots?
I think there were four total.
Okay. Yeah. So there was the hip. There was...
He got her arm because he broke a bone in her arm.
And then there was her head and a finger.
Yeah.
And they thought maybe the finger got shot at the same time as her head, like she was holding her head.
Yeah.
But then some experts said no, because there was no blood from her head or head material on her hand.
On her hand.
Which I guess it doesn't really matter.
No, but he shot three or four bullets through there.
Yes, I think four. I think you're right.
With the intention of killing whoever was behind the door.
Right. So whether it was her or not, it was murder.
Yeah. Because again, we get back to, let's suppose it was an intruder.
Okay, let's pretend for a minute.
And we got this person barricaded in the bathroom in the toilet door.
Right.
And you say, I have a gun. I'm going to call the police.
That would be reasonable.
Right.
Because there's not even any indication, if it was an intruder, that they were armed.
Right. There was no...
There were no threats.
No threats or harm done to Oscar or Reeva.
Right.
In the bedroom or anything like that.
Yes.
So, I guess maybe he was so cranked up, his adrenaline was flowing, and he just knew there was an intruder behind the door and he was shooting. But please, that wasn't the case. They had an argument because there was already some second thoughts or misgivings, despite the fact that she brought a Valentine's gift for him. But there was already some second thoughts about this relationship.
She had made that clear in some of her texts.
Right. And there were witnesses that heard arguments or people arguing.
That's true.
Before the shots rang out.
Right.
So that's, to me, what makes it a premeditated thing.
Well, that doctor seeing her in the bathroom, moving around, seeing someone in the bathroom.
Right.
That confirms it for me. If you believe him, like I said, you have to believe that he did it on purpose.
He did.
So the statement that the judges made, it read, although he may have been anxious, it is inconceivable that a rational person would have believed he was entitled to fire at this person. Is it?
Well, no.
No.
Makes him guilty.
Makes him guilty and, you know, maybe he's having some...
Repentant.
Repentant.
The court also heard testimony about messages sent on iPhones between Oscar and Reeva. 90% of the messages were loving and normal conversations.
Right.
But there were several where Reeva accused Oscar of being jealous and possessive, which he probably denied.
Yes. So in one message that Reeva sent less than 3 weeks before the shooting, she wrote, "I'm scared of you sometimes, of how you snap at me." And then she went on to describe his behavior as being nasty. Now, Oscar testified in his own defense, and his cross-examination was brutal.
Bet it was.
So the cross-examination took 5 days, and then the re-examination by his attorney only took 10 minutes. And that ended with Oscar reading Reeva's Valentine's Day card to him, which he said he opened the August after he killed her. And it read, "I think today is a good day to tell you that I love you." And the judge would say that this is just irrelevant.
Well, I would agree.
Yeah.
What's that got to do with anything?
It's true.
This was before she got killed that she wrote this.
Well, yes, she didn't write anything after, clearly. Right.
I mean, so, who cares?
Right. Just because she loved him has no bearing on the fact that he killed her.
None whatsoever.
Yes, I agree. The prosecution asked to have Oscar's mental condition evaluated independently after testimony from a psychiatrist for the defense had claimed that he had an anxiety disorder that made him hypervigilant about security. So they were also saying that being a disabled person made him feel more vulnerable than other people. So that would make him hypervigilant, anxious.
Well, I think you could be hypervigilant and anxious just because of the high crime rate. I'm not sure that I'd agree with the statement that being disabled made him more vigilant. I mean, he was pretty easily overcoming this disability.
Yes.
He had his prostheses that he could slip on very quickly.
Yes. Yes. Well, so having a fear of crime in South Africa is a reasonable thing. It is a problem there, violence.
There's a lot of crime and violence in South Africa. That's why people are living in these gated communities with barbed wire or along fences and stuff. I mean, it must be difficult if you're a higher income person to be living there and be worried about your safety all the time.
Yes. Yep.
And they have a lot of gun-related deaths. Speaking of shooting people.
Okay.
The interesting thing is that...
Say that this experience left her fearful, left a mark on her as well. So she's this beautiful woman who seems to have everything, but she's been through some stuff.
She certainly has.
So she's a strong person.
There's some life-altering events there.
Absolutely. Now, she attended college and completed her law degree. She worked as a paralegal as well as a model. Then in 2011, she applied to the bar, and she planned to be a legal advocate by the time she was 30. But we know she never made it to 30.
No.
Now, as a model, Reeva was ranked number 40 in the FHM 100 Sexiest Women in the World poll of South African readers in 2011. And she was number 45 in 2012. So she's doing pretty well with this modeling.
It sounds like. Although she dropped a few spots from 2011 to 2012.
Sure, but the competition must be fierce.
I'm sure it is.
She was a celebrity face in the Spirit Day anti-bullying campaign as well in 2012. And she was also the primary model for Avon in South Africa.
Now that sounds like a pretty big deal.
A good gig, yeah.
Yeah.
Now Reeva also wanted to be an actress on television. She once worked as a presenter for Fashion TV in South Africa, and she also starred in television ads for Toyota, Reds, and Alder Pin Pop, which I'm not sure what that is. Might be a South African brand.
I would think, yeah. Now, is she still doing law degree stuff? It sounds like she's spending more time modeling and trying to get into TV and movies.
Well, she was, but she also did. She did apply for the bar, so I think she was juggling both.
Okay.
Now, at the time of her death, Reeva was signed up to appear on season 5 of the reality TV show, Tropica Island of Treasure. And she'd filmed the series episodes on location in Jamaica. The series began airing as scheduled on February 16th, 2013, and that was just 2 days after her death. The first episode of the series was dedicated to Reeva, and was preceded by a video tribute to her. Now, Reeva had just begun dating Oscar Pistorius in November of 2012. Oscar was born in 1986, So he was 3 years younger than Reeva, and he was born in Johannesburg, South Africa. He grew up with an older brother and a younger sister. Oscar was born with fibular hemimelia. Did I say that right?
You did.
Okay.
So what that means is he's missing the two smaller leg bones in each leg.
Right, the lower leg.
The lower leg. He has the tibia.
Which is the shin.
The shin bone. The fibula sits next to it. So he's missing those.
So did he have feet?
I'm not sure.
Basically.
Yeah. But don't they, I mean, in the United States, each side has their own expert to testify to that.
Yeah.
So.
Well, maybe they didn't think it was going to be an issue until then.
So the defense had a psychiatric expert, but the prosecution didn't. And they said, oh, wait a minute, we need to.
I guess so. I mean, I'm not sure exactly how it went, but yes. They went ahead and had an evaluation. And the evaluation found that Oscar was not mentally incapacitated to the extent where he could not tell right from wrong. But it did say that he suffered from some anxiety and PTSD.
Definitely.
Which I don't think is really a mitigating factor in this case.
No.
Now, the surgeon who had amputated Oscar's lower legs when he was 11 months old testified about the effects of walking or standing on stumps, and then an acoustic engineer testified that if Reeva was screaming in the toilet room, it was unlikely that the screams would be audible or intelligible to the witnesses who testified earlier. But then in cross-examination, the expert conceded that it was possible that they had heard Reeva. I imagine if you're screaming for your life, you're screaming loudly.
Yeah. So, and the defense is saying that all these people were hallucinating?
That they thought they heard a woman, but they didn't. And that some of their times were wrong. So these witnesses weren't given a lot of credit.
No, they weren't. But I was impressed with how they stuck to their stories.
They did. Mm-hmm. Now, in the closing arguments, the prosecutor said that Oscar had concocted a snowball of lies and demanded that he face the consequences. The defense attorney described Oscar's reaction to danger as being like that of an abused woman, which I find ironic.
No kidding. More than ironic.
Yes. So they're saying because he's a disabled person living in a high crime area, that he's emotionally damaged like an abused woman.
It's almost laughable.
So in the verdict, Oscar Pistorius was convicted only of culpable homicide, not murder. He was acquitted of murder. And then there was a sentencing hearing from October 13th to October 21st, and they gave him a sentence of a maximum of 5 years. So he received a 3-year suspended prison sentence for the separate reckless endangerment conviction for the gun, and then the 5 years for the murder. Well, for the culpable homicide.
Culpable homicide.
Right.
Sounds like a slap on the wrist.
A lot of people felt that way. So the prosecution had accused Oscar of premeditated murder, right? But the judge told the court that the state had failed to prove beyond reasonable doubt that he had committed premeditated murder. Based on objective facts, she accepted the defense's timeline that shots were fired around 3:12.
Who is also a former newspaper columnist and candidate for mayor of Durham, was convicted of first-degree murder in connection with her death in 2003 and sentenced to life in prison without parole. However, in 2011, he was ordered released, pending a new trial by Superior Court Judge Orlando Hudson. Hudson found that State Bureau of Investigation blood analyst Dwayne Deaver gave false and misleading testimony at Peterson's first trial.
Right.
He certainly did.
He did.
The North Carolina Supreme Court later upheld that decision.
So this is a case that stayed with me ever since we did it. And it was our maybe it was our second thing that we did for a podcast. Very early on, really super bad audio quality, but it's one that really stuck with me. It was a 10-part documentary, a fascinating case. And I don't think he did it. Do you think he did it? How do you feel about that now, looking back?
No, I think when we look back on it, that there was enough evidence that he didn't do it.
Right. And you know what I really have believed in lately is the owl theory, which I think I actually believed in that back when we did it. So maybe it's not new.
It's not new.
But
you were promoting that theory.
Well, they did a whole episode on it on the podcast Criminal a little while back, where they spoke to a neighbor who'd been attacked by an owl. So if you have a chance to listen to that, it's just like a little half-hour episode. And what owls can actually do, and it makes a lot of sense. If you look at her wounds, there was a neighbor nearby who was attacked by an owl.
Mm-hmm.
She'd been drinking. She could have gone out front, and the owl could have hit her in the head, done the damage, and then if she tried to get up the stairs and fell, I mean, it really would explain the whole thing.
I think it could.
I don't really see that he had a motive to kill her. I don't see him as killing her.
No.
No, so it's interesting. I really am definitely going to follow that.
Yeah, we'll have to keep an eye on when the trial starts.
Yeah, we might do another episode on that, because this is a fascinating case.
I think it would be worthwhile.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to start looking into where he's been and what's going on with that. So this lawyer, do you think she's still working with his legal team he had before?
Doesn't say.
Okay, so we'll have to check that out.
Yeah, the gist of the article is that they're going to have to decide how the DNA evidence is held up and whether they can present it. Okay. Or retest it.
Well, what's the DNA evidence? I mean, what kind of DNA are we looking at there? She was leaning all over the stairway.
Yeah.
What was his DNA involved? I don't know. Because they said that he had hit her with a stick.
With the blowpipe.
Right. So I didn't think DNA was a big part of it. So I don't know about that.
Well, there's a controversy about how accurate the DNA evidence could be at this stage.
Okay. So, all right, so that'll be really interesting to follow. It's coming up.
I took the opportunity away from the microphone to get a good look at my family. I lit a cigarette and let the rhythm section carry on for a bit, smiled back, and tipped my bottled water their way for subtle cheers to all of them, but especially to my aunts. You might remember them from the extensive media coverage of the murder of Sarah Tokars, but for the sake of clarity and to give credit where it is due, I'm going to list them here. The Ambruska girls are Therese, Gretchen, Mary, Sarah, Joni, Karen, and Chrissy. They are all wonderful and have gone above and beyond for Rick and me. In the wake of such a deranged adversity, we were and are very lucky to have them. And in regard to my father, his name is Dr. John Ambrusco.
He turned out to be quite a young man. What a great writer.
Yeah. My grandfather always wanted boys. Ended up with two as an old man. He is the reason that Rick and I survived. It was through his example that we learned to be strong and composed, to work hard, and to pray. What a nice story.
That's great. That's so sad, but also really impressed. Sarah would be proud.
It looks like.
Yeah, that's very touching. It's hard to move on from that. So I have Georgette from New York, who wrote to us about the Lacey Spears appeal. So a panel of appellate judges were considering their request by Lacey Spears to overturn her murder conviction for the salt poisoning death of her son Garnett. The crux of her defense lawyer's argument is that the evidence against Spears was not legally sufficient to support her conviction. The lawyers are also...
I would disagree, but anyway.
The lawyers are also challenging judicial rulings that argue... They argue deprived Spears of a fair trial. Oral arguments had been scheduled, but both sides relied on written briefs they submitted, waiving an in-person appearance. So, basically, Lacey's appealing her conviction. She wants a new trial. She says, following the 5-week trial in 2015, the jury convicted Spears of second-degree murder under the theory that she showed a depraved indifference to human life. The theory is different than an intentional killing, but carries the same punishment. Acting State Supreme Court Justice Robert Neary sentenced her to 20 years in prison. So since she's been in prison, she's complained about being harassed. Remember, we talked in her episode about how inmates would put salt on her food.
Yeah.
People who kill children do not fare well in prison.
No, they don't.
Which seems fair enough to me. But even the second degree, I don't know if that's great, because I feel like maybe he was starting to talk and maybe she purposely did kill him at that point. There's a good possibility of that to me. The psychology of it and how that happens.
Right.
Because she knew better.
She did.
And she was obviously, well, I don't know if it's obvious, but most likely she was in a relationship that was unhealthy, where she was being mistreated, at least verbally.
It sure seems that way.
And look how it ended.
Yes.
Yeah. So it really makes you think if that could happen to someone who's beautiful, successful, seems confident, seems aware of domestic violence, then it really could happen to any one of us.
Yeah, it's kind of insidious.
It is, right. So that's why it's just really important to me that we don't put any blame on someone just because they're with someone who's famous. I mean, there are all kinds of things that attract people.
Yes, there are.
Right. Okay. So that's all I have to say about that.
Okay.
Anything else on this case you want to talk about?
No, only that he got off easy.
He seems to, but you know, I've noticed in other countries, they do seem to have shorter sentences in many of them.
They do.
I mean, remember, Ireland with Rachel O'Reilly's husband?
Yeah.
They don't get life like they do here quite as often, do they?
No, they sure don't.
No. Which sometimes I wonder about life sentences. Sometimes that does seem ridiculously long.
Well, that's a whole other topic.
Okay.
Isn't it?
All right. So you don't want to delve into that right now?
No.
As we're winding down.
I think if we're in the wind down phase of this discussion, this probably isn't the time to get into that discussion.
Okay. Yeah, and plus we have a lot of feedback to do today.
Right.
So sometimes, Dickie, when I'm out walking the dogs, complete strangers run up to me and they say, Jill, Jill, can I join Team Tie Grabber? And I say, well, yes. And you know, they don't even seem just surprised. They seem really relieved.
Well, I would be.
Yeah.
Because if I were just an ordinary person not having anything to do with this, I would want to be a member of Team Tie Grabber.
Well, because you're a cool kind of with-it guy that's always in on the best stuff.
And especially if I see this good-looking woman walking her dogs, I'd be going up to her anyway.
Good-looking dogs, too, right?
Well, they are.
They're older, but they're pretty good-looking.
We'll say mature.
Yes. Well, I say to them, I say it's easy. You just go to tiegrabber.com, and you click on Join Team Tie Grabber.
Now, that's all you got to do?
That's all you got to do.
Well.
But sometimes the really fanatical ones, they'll follow up asking that by asking, how else can I support the podcast, though?
Well, I'm sure there's other ways, right?
Because they're not satisfied with just that. They're fanatical types.
Yes.
So I just smile at them, and all I have to say is, shop the brewery.
Shop the brewery.
And they know what that means. I mean, these people are with it.
These are hip people.
Yeah, they're not people that don't know what's going on.
These are hip people.
Yes. So, no further explanations needed after that, right? It's all...
Well, no, because again...
Then they know that address out there for pretty much anyone who asks.
That's right.
Okay, so let's take a little musical break and then we'll talk some feedback. I've got some good stuff this week.
Okay, let's look at them.
All right. I got guns in my head and they won't go. Spirits in my head and they won't go. I got guns in my head and they won't go. Spirits in my head and they won't go. I'd just like to take a minute to remind everyone about our Amazon link, tiegrabber.com/Amazon. For no additional cost to you, you can support True Crime Brewery by doing your shopping through our link. So that's tiegrabber.com/Amazon. If you have a minute to do that, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Okay, welcome to feedback.
So I have one from YouTube feedback on Lying in Wait, the murders of Haley Kiefer and Nicholas Brady.
Very haunting case, yeah.
Very haunting. I have actually two persons doing feedback. The first one is from Dominique and Kaylee Vlog. Is that like a vlog or something? I don't know what that is.
I don't know what it is. Like a blog. I don't know.
Yeah. So they say, I have nightmares about this audio. I have my own kids, and they make mistakes. I know I did at 17. Not saying stealing is right, but it's not at all. But this case was a lunatic not laying in wait to catch intruders. He laid in wait at the ready tarp and all to kill the intruders, which happened to be these teens. This killer had plenty of opportunity and time to dial 911, but never did. He watched him outside, didn't call. He heard his window break, didn't call. He shot and executed them, implied that she was going to lose a meal ticket.
No, because...
If she charged him or separated from him.
Right, because there are plenty of women who stay with poor men who beat them.
Right.
So there's the battered women syndrome, which is a whole separate thing.
There is. So
also,
we'll leave it at that. Or I'll leave it at that.
No, you can keep talking, because also I'm thinking there could have been pressure on her from other people, right? Because if someone's a pro athlete, there are a lot of people that want him to succeed that are depending on him.
That's true.
Right? Because who else has to gain from him being famous or being on a good football team? And not being arrested.
His entourage.
So who's his entourage?
Well, his friends, the hangers-on. I mean, there's plenty of people.
Agent,
yeah.
Right. So she could have had pressure from other people as well. Like, well, if you let him get in trouble for this, we're going to all lose our jobs or whatever.
Yeah. Maybe they're putting it out as for the greater good.
What do you mean?
Of everybody.
Sure. Well, I could see there'd be pressure in that group of people.
Yeah.
Because he might be a meal ticket for several people, not just her.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
And then the thing with Reeva is, she might have, part of her attraction to Oscar may have been his fame and his athleticism. But just because she's attracted to him for that, that has nothing to do with the fact that she's in an abusive relationship.
No, you're right. It doesn't.
And I think it's really strange that she was very much into activism against domestic violence. But even she could be caught in a relationship like that. What does that tell you?
I know.
Yeah.
It makes you think.
It does make you think about the whole psychology of it and how that happens.
Right.
Because she knew better.
She did.
And she was obviously, well, I don't know if it's obvious, but most likely she was in a relationship that was unhealthy, where she was being mistreated, at least verbally.
It sure seems that way.
And look how it ended.
Yes.
Yeah. So it really makes you think if that could happen to someone who's beautiful, successful, seems confident, seems aware of domestic violence, then it really could happen to any one of us.
Yeah. It's kind of insidious.
It is, right. So that's why it's just really important to me that we don't put any blame on someone just because they're with someone who's famous. I mean, there are all kinds of things that attract people.
Yes, there are.
Right. Okay. So that's all I have to say about that.
Okay.
Anything else on this case you want to talk about?
No, only that he got off easy.
He seems to, but you know, I've noticed in other countries, they do seem to have shorter sentences in many of them.
They do.
I mean, remember, Ireland with Rachel O'Reilly's husband?
Yeah.
They don't get life like they do here quite as often, do they?
No, they sure don't.
No. Which sometimes I wonder about life sentences. Sometimes that does seem... That was it, huh?
A decade earlier, we were saying if Dad had been there, he would have shot him. And talking about Mom ended there. I realize that this looks sad on paper, but the fact of the matter is Rick and I don't need to discuss our lives before November 29th, 1992. I know how Rick feels about it, and Rick knows how I feel about it. We remember we were there. We've been thinking about it every day for 20 years, so there is no need to say it out loud. But this is not to say that Sarah Tokars has been absent from our lives during the last two decades. Not at all, actually. I speak about my mother frequently, to close friends who knew what happened, and also to acquaintances who don't. I never get it heavy outside of familiar zones, and have grown into a habit of talking about her the way other people talk about their mothers who are alive, because it's not necessary to include the horrible detail. Once I bragged to a cute hipster chick from Colorado that my mom went to college in Boulder in the 70s. I suppose I do this because I wish I was someone with the option of talking about my mom as if she were alive.
That makes me want to cry.
Yeah, isn't it?
That's really touching.
We survived, thanks to six amazing aunts and one strong uncle. I do, however, bring up the murder when talking with my aunts, the Ambrusco sisters. These are Sarah's sisters.
Yeah, she had six sisters.
Who, despite the immeasurable and ongoing sadness they'd been forced to cope with, continued making extraordinary efforts to keep Sarah alive for Rick and me. And I do feel her in all of them, in six separate ways that come from each sister's similar but unique relationship with my mom. But there is also an all-encompassing force which they share as a whole. Attempting to describe this internal reaction would be useless, but I have observed the spirit does not come from an individual source, but from all of their efforts combined. It feels safe and warm, like Mass on Christmas morning. When I graduated from the University of South Florida last year, not a single aunt missed the commencement. They brought all the available uncles and cousins from each corner of America down to swampy Florida, the land of runaways and fresh starts where Rick and I grew up. All six of the Ambrusco girls sat together in place of their middle sister Sarah, who I'm told once made a heck of a cheerleader, and cheered for me, the fortunate orphan. Later that night at a beach bar near our home in Bradenton, the entire family gathered around a table, drinking and laughing and smiling together, watching me on stage while I was playing guitar and singing with my band. At one point during our second set, while we were riffing on some instrumental number, I took the opportunity away from the microphone to get a good look at my family. I lit a cigarette and let the rhythm...
Mutations.
Right, in the Paralympics, which follow the Olympics.
Right.
He lost in the 200-meter run to a guy, and Pistorius cried foul.
That's what I was going to say.
Which is kind of funny to me, because he was at the center of the controversy originally about gaining an advantage, and his claim was that the guy who beat him had an advantage because his blades were bigger or something.
Right. So some people have said that this was an insight, a look at how he could be kind of a poor sport, kind of a angry person.
I think from what we've read and what we've seen, there's a lot of indicators that he had some flaws in his character.
Okay, yeah.
I'll leave it at that for now.
He didn't seem to when he was younger. I kind of thought what they'd said, that the fame kind of made him a...
Well, yeah.
Big,
yeah,
head,
we've,
you know,
we've talked about
big
this
ego.
Before. You get enough people telling you how great you are, you start believing that.
Right.
So that's what happened with him.
Okay. And he became quite famous, especially in South Africa.
Yeah.
And he became known as the Blade Runner.
Right.
So he had sponsorship deals worth $2 million a year.
He was making pretty good money.
Yep. Sponsors included Nike, Gatorade, and Oakley.
Yeah, those are big guys.
Big ones. He purchased his home in a gated community, and he became interested in fast cars, speedboats, and then eventually guns. He owned several guns.
A lot of guns.
In 2009, he'd been seriously injured when he was thrown from a boat that he was speeding in on the Vaal River. The Vaal or Vaal?
Vaal.
Vaal River near Johannesburg.
I'm trying to translate into Dutch to German or something like that, so I think it's Vaal.
Okay. And he required surgery for some broken facial bones, but he recovered pretty quickly from that.
Yeah, there was some controversy about that, and whether he was driving the boat or not, whether there was alcohol involved.
Really?
So there was some things that might have gotten brushed under the table.
There was some talk that he had a friend take the blame.
Right.
Because he was famous.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we will see this happen another time, too.
Right. It's true. Well, Oscar and Reeva had only been dating for 3 months when he killed her. According to Reeva's friends, she did love Oscar, but her relationship with Oscar had changed over this short course of their relationship. I mean, it's only been 3 months. If things are already changing, that's worrisome.
Well, definitely. And not just the length of time. I mean, you hardly know this guy, right?
Right.
Or vice versa. You hardly know each other. And things have already turned rather volatile.
That's not a good sign.
It's definitely not a good sign.
No. Well, some friends of Reeva would say that Oscar was very possessive and he had a temper. But Reeva